Ah, yes. The PS2. Probably regarded as one of the best consoles ever made. You know, I actually remember the day that I got my first PS2, and I've been through a lot of them since. They're not the most reliable console ever. But it was Christmas Day of 2002, and I woke up, and Father Christmas had been. He'd left me a new PS2, and also this game. But before we talk about this game, let's talk about movie games as a whole. Now, back in the day of the PS2's prime time, loads and loads of movie games existed for the system, and also other systems as well. If a movie was about to hit the big screen, then almost certainly a game based on the movie would be releasing around the same time. This process got so crazy that we would see games based on a movie based on a game. Not to mention for some of the movies, like the one we're going to talk about today, there was already a book counterpart which the movie was based on, and the game is then based on the movie adaptation of that book. Yes, don't worry, I'm also confused. This process wasn't something I was trying to highlight, but I wanted to explain how movie games have just vanished from the market these days. The only examples I can think of nowadays of movie-based games are the Lego games, and I think there was that new Jurassic World game that you can play, but I'm not sure if that's directly related to the movie or not. The reason for this is probably due to the rise in popularity of smartphones, so then developers just make an app for the respective movie adaptation, and obviously it'll require a lot less development time than, say, a fully-fledged game. In fact, nowadays, now that I think about it, we probably see more movies based on games rather than games based on movies. But let's not get bogged down on who's made a game about what movie. More importantly, let's actually talk about the game, Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets. This is a game that I've wanted to talk about for such a long time, and especially to a wide audience, because this is my first ever PS2 game. It has a lot of memories with me. So in this video, we're just gonna see how well it holds up and whether it's still as good as I remember it.
Oh, God, no.
I haven't even opened the box yet, and we've already got a problem. In 2002, EA Games, good company, thumbs up. In 2018, thumbs down. Yeah, it's not great nowadays, is it? Back when I recorded all of the gameplay footage in the background in November last year, EA was going through quite a lot of backlash from the Battlefront 2 loot box system, which is something they're still trying to recover from to this day. Especially after watching their E3 conference, where they were talking about, oh, no more loot boxes, yay, when they shouldn't have really existed in the first place. So, in that regard, I think it'll be interesting to look at this in another way as well. Whether or not this single player offline experience is better than what EA are doing today. Basically, is the past better than the future? So let's just cut to the chase and talk about this goddamn game already. Before we boot up the game though, let's have a look at the front cover. It looks lovely, it's great, apart from the EA Games logo, but other than that it looks fine. On the back it has a particularly long blurb about the whole game, but what I particularly like is that it says, "But this time the spells are more amazing, the foes are more fearsome, and Harry's friends are more important than ever." Now, from that description, and from when we jump into this game ourselves, I can tell you that that last part about his friends is absolute shit, because they don't do anything in this game. What I also love about old game boxes is there's always the tagline of cutting-edge graphics, but when you replay them nowadays, they really don't hold up. Anyway, with that all said and done, let's boot up the game.
If Harry Potter goes back to Hogwarts, he will be in mortal danger.
Ron, look!
Yep, the game crashed. Probably because the disc has a million scratches on it. But no matter, not like anything in that FMV has any relevance to the game whatsoever. Thankfully, we can skip that scene and actually play the game. After a 28-second load screen, the game starts by Harry and Ron returning from a mad sesh in Toon at 4 a.m. in the morning. And within the first 5 seconds, we're met with a continuity error. In the car, you can see that just Harry and Ron are there, but then Fred and George are getting told off by Mrs. Weasley for being in the car. I also like how the camera moves in front of the buildings, so then they didn't have to animate the door or anything inside of the house. So then you just hear all the characters plop on the ground, and they appear, and they all sort of bash into each other a little bit before they actually start moving correctly. I think I'm actually tearing up my childhood and other people's childhood by overanalyzing this kind of stuff, so I think I'm going to stop. By the way, it's also worth noting that if you're a fan of Dobby, he doesn't appear in this game whatsoever, and none of the voice actors are from the movie, apart from a few select few, such as John Cleese. Anyway, for the actual gameplay, if you've ever played a Zelda game in your life, then you'll feel right at home with this. The top right shows you what spells you have assigned to which buttons, and you can change those within the inventory as you learn more spells and get more items. Other than that though, you use the R1 button to target things, and use the L2, R2, and right analog stick to move the camera around. If you've ever played one of your older games before, you'll also notice that it feels a little clunky, and that's sort of how this feels as well. Once you smash a pot with Flipendo like a badass, the game explains to you about the Remember All, which shows you what your mission objectives are, and you can also end the day with that once you have finished your mission objectives, along with the collectible items, the Bertie Bot Every Flavored Beans. These beans are one of two types of currency within this game, and you'll use those to buy things at Hogwarts. So where do you collect these beans? In bins, bushes, and bookshelves, of course. Because that makes complete sense. They're not even in packaging, so they're probably covered in shit and hairs and... ugh, who would want those? Anyway, we start doing some denoming and we target these little naked grey Shrek-looking things, and then we fight a washing machine. I don't think anybody has ever said that. After destroying the washing machine, we get a chocolate frog, which restores all of our health, and then we get introduced to another collectible, which is the wizard cards, which, if you've ever played Zelda before, they're pretty much the heart pieces of this game. Every 10 you collect, you get a bit more health, and there are 101 of them in the game, and these early ones especially are missable. Finally, to finish off at the burrow, we get some more little naked Shrek things, and we hit them, and we spin them around and throw them as far as we can.
What's that? Animal cruelty?
Yeah, Harry doesn't have any fucks to give for that.
Watch me 360 no scope this Shrek baby fadget. First you knock the shit out of it.
Wow! Gotta try this!
Then you spin real fast and fucking lob it.
What a noob.
Fuck of me.
Once we get bored of performing animal cruelty, Mrs. Weasley comes out and tells you how great you are at it, and then you go to bed. The scene that follows is a little weird because it then has Stephen Fry narrating it, And this makes me wonder whether or not they've just ripped the audio from the Chamber of Secrets audiobook on cassette. God, half of you probably don't even know what a cassette is. I feel so old. Blah, blah, blah. Everybody knows the story to Chamber of Secrets. And after a 35-second load screen, we arrive in Bergenschot, somehow not burning ourselves. I keep mentioning the load times because literally every single load screen in this game takes at least 20 seconds to load. We're at the point in the game where something's a bit weird. The sort of dark themes from Harry Potter start to appear, and the game does a really, really good job of creating that darkness. Perhaps too well, as we'll see in a bit. Anyway, the Malfoys come in and they say they're embarrassed by this spellbook that they have, which is a bit weird. That's sort of like me saying I'm embarrassed by this revision guide I own. They leave the book, we creep past the scary hand, and we read it and learn Lumos.
Wow, the Lumos spell! Maybe I could use this to find my way out.
Lumos is used to light up dark areas and to find secret passages in walls. Continuing onward, we've run into some imps, which we obviously have to fight, even though they're innocent creatures, and then we imprison them and climb on top of them. So yeah, we're really adding to the animal cruelty right here. We then climb on top of said imprisoned imps and collect an owl treat to call Hedwig for us to lower the ladder. God, this is so complicated. To finish off, we climb up the ladder, walk across the disintegrating attic, and then we solve a little puzzle outside which has some buttons which make some really scary noises. And we finally arrive outside. We meet Ginny and Mrs. Weasley, who tell us that Ginny has lost all of her three items that she needs for Hogwarts. Us being the amazing protagonist that we are, we offer to help, and we are rewarded with
a silver sickle!
The silver sickles are the second type of currency that I mentioned earlier. With this silver sickle that we have earned, we can go and buy the spellbook, which makes all of our spells become charged and more powerful. With this, we can now smash some barrels like a true Zelda game and earn some more silver sickles. And then I trade those sickles in for a Wigan Well potion vial, which is essentially a bottle with a fairy in it in Zelda terms. You can then refill that bottle whenever you use it from the Wigan Well potion cauldrons.
That door's locked.
Wait, what's he doing over there? Is he the Diagon Alley drug dealer? Right next to the joke shop. How do I exchange beans for drugs? I then head back to Diagon Alley, go to the joke shop, and after a 45-second load screen, I go into the joke shop and collect the first of Ginny's items by hitting a target with a charged spell and crawling into the back room of the joke shop. That sounds really, really wrong. We then head to the leaky cauldron to find Ginny's sellotape and get tempted by a silver sickle, which leads to us falling into the basement of the leaky cauldron. Now trapped in the leaky cauldron's basement, we are faced with some more challenges like imprisoning imps, rolling barrels, and nearly getting crushed to death by a pipe. After all that, we find the sellotape back in the starting room, and we can finally collect that sickle. Unfortunately though, I'm hit with a problem. The game died. I've had that copy of Chamber of Secrets for 15 years. 15 years! And it's finally died. I should probably do some sort of funeral for it or something. So I guess that means end of video. Thanks a lot for watching and see you next time.
Why do people do that joke? They can just see the timer at the bottom.
But it is not rest and kill because I went on the internet and I bought another copy for £3. More excitingly though, this copy came with a manual. In terms of the manual as a whole, it's actually quite cool. It has loads of references to the Harry Potter books, and some little wizarding facts which you might find interesting if you're a big Harry Potter buff. For example, they have sentences like this. Follow these simple instructions to denome like a modern-day Beaumont Marjorie Banks, who is the pioneer of herbology and discovered gillyweed. Another one they have is about the wizard money, which states that students from non-magical families should note that there are 17 sickles to the galleon and 29 canuts to a sickle. The reason I'm telling you all this is because I just want you to bear in mind that the people who made that manual want you to think that they are the biggest Harry Potter buffs ever, okay? They know their stuff. The final thing of note on this manual is the 24-hour hotline for gameplay hints and tips. You see, EA found a way to get the microtransactions in there. They found a way. To be fair though, a lot of companies did this back in the times when the internet wasn't as popular as it is certainly now. Calls cost from the UK are charged at 75p per minute. And this is back in 2002 before Brexit, when the pound was actually worth something. Now, I think I would be doing everybody, and myself included, a disservice if I didn't call that number. Okay then, let's go get some tips for the Chamber of Secrets.
Okay, let's give them a call. Let's put it on speaker. Well, that was disappointing. Invalid number. Try again, just in case, you know. Oh. You know what? I was half hoping it'd be a sex line, and then I could do a funny joke, but I don't even know what to do now. That's been ruined.
Okay, situation update. I checked the next Harry Potter games, Prisoner of Azkaban, Goblet of Fire, and also Order of the Phoenix, and they have a different hotline number, and they're all the same, obviously. So, let's give that number a call.
Okay, let's try this one then. So it's actually a little bit different, but it's the same starting bit. 5354 55. Let's try that one.
Welcome to the Electronic Arts official hints and tips line.
Oh my god.
Pressing star at any time will bring you back to this main menu. Pressing the hash key while listening to a game will take you back one level in the service. This is the main menu. If you know your game code, press 1 now. If you don't know your game code and want help finding your game, press 2.
That'll be number 2 then.
Using your telephone keypad, please enter the first 4 letters of the game you're looking for. This is done in a similar way to predictive texting.
Okay, H-A-double-R.
Press 1 for hints for Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince on all formats. 2 for hints for Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix on all platforms. 3 for tips and sheets for Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire on all platforms. 4 for wizard guard location for Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban on PC. 5 for the play guide and hints for Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban on PlayStation 2, GameCube and Xbox. 6 for the play guide for Harry Potter's Philosopher's Stone on Game Boy Advance and Game Boy Color. 7 for Harry Potter's Philosopher's Stone Next Generation shield locations on PS2, GameCube and Xbox. 8 for the wizard card guide for Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets. You have selected the wizard card guide for Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets on PlayStation 2. Press 1 to accept or 2 to re-enter. Please have a pen and paper handy to make any relevant notes.
I don't have a pen and paper.
You can rewind and fast forward by a few seconds by pushing 4 and 6, and to pause, push 5. To unpause, press 5 again.
For the wizard cards in the following locations, the Burrow, Morgan and Burks, or Diagon Alley, press 1. For the wizard cards in the following locations,
press 1. Yeah, why not?
The Burrow. There are four cards in the Burrow. For one, Merlin. Hit the tongue.
Oh. Ah. I've just run out of credit. So, I hope you enjoyed that. I've now got no credit. That was disappointing. I'll never know where those cards were. Oh God. Oh God, no. I am genuinely surprised that still works. I'm stunned. I was really, really expecting a sex line, but wow, EA, wow. I wonder how many people have called that in the past, I don't know, 10 years maybe? You know, half of me really, really wants to ring that again just so I can hear where the cards are, and then just hear like how bad the locations will be. But I ain't giving any more money to AA. No way. On a final note about that call, I find it funny how the quality of the voice drops significantly when you get to the cheats of the actual game you're looking for, as if they've recorded the person on a cassette player, and then you're just controlling that cassette player with your phone. Anyway, back to the game, and we have one item left to get for Ginny. The final item, though, introduces a new gameplay mechanic, sneaking. Essentially, the aim is to get the objective done without being caught. But if you are seen, then you still have a chance to escape, so long as you don't get hit by their spell. For this particular mission, we have to press the button and go for the door to collect the final item without being caught. So we do just that, get the item, and leave without being seen. There is a bit more to discuss about the whole sneaking mechanic, but we'll get back to that in a bit. With all the items in tow, we return them to Ginny, we get a really underwhelming wizard card for it, and then Mrs. Weasley tells us to go and see Lockhart. So now I'm going to show you part of this story scene, and I want you to think, what is wrong with it?
I suppose your parents will go hungry for a month to pay for all the books you're going to need at Hogwarts. Here, girl, take this one. It's the least I can do to help out the poor and needy.
Let me give you some coaching, Harry. Fame is a fickle friend, and I would encourage you to be careful how you play the fame game, so to speak. Be sparing with your public appearances at first, and watch the company you keep.
Harry! Well, Harry, with Mr. Train!
Miss the Train?
Yes! The Hogwarts Express left 5 minutes ago!
Oh no! What are we going to do?
Well, I know that Dad took the flying car to work this morning. It's parked in Charing Cross Road.
Okay, it's our only chance of getting to school on time.
In the wilds of Stratton-on-Tees that I managed to regain my former prominent position as the world's most popular wizard. Harry? Oh.
So, what do you think it is? If you said everything, you're right. Let's just analyse this scene. Ginny, Draco, and Mr. Malfoy all leave at the same time. Now, between that time and when Ron tells us that the Hogwarts Express left 5 minutes ago, 12 seconds had elapsed during Lockhart's speech. Do you remember that we arrived at the Burrow and there was no mention of Dobby whatsoever? Of course, in the actual Chamber of Secrets, Dobby locks access to Platform 9 and 3 quarters, but obviously they can't do that because they never introduced Dobby in the first place. So what they had to do was completely rewrite this scene so that they have this really, really, really stupid scenario. And also there's the fact with Ginny, Draco and Mr. Malfoy all leaving 12 seconds prior, how the hell did they get to Platform 9 and 3 quarters in time to get the Hogwarts Express? Last time I checked, I don't think Diagon Alley was 12 seconds away from the platform. And also there's the fact with Ron just appearing out of nowhere, and if you recall, you can hear a little bell go when they leave the shop. But you don't hear that, Ron just appears. The only way to explain that is that Ron was in the shop already, and that sort of makes sense. But when you see him in the opening shot, he's not there, unless he's off to the far left. Now if he was off to the far left, what the hell was he doing over there? I don't know, was he looking for beans or something? I don't know, man. So whatever, we get in the car with Ron and we drive to Hogwarts. The next story scene doesn't make much sense either, because we fly past the Whomping Willow 3 times in a row. Ron jumps out and commits suicide because he's fed up of these continuity errors. I've only just noticed now, but I like how Harry does a double take at the driver's seat. He's just like, oh shit. We somehow survive a head-on collision with a tree though, and then Ron is just really ungrateful. You know, we're gonna try and save him, and he's just being a little bitch. Now, I remember as a kid really getting confused about where to go in this level, and this is probably intentional by EA, you know, so then you use that game tips phone number. What you're supposed to do is sidle along the far wall and then throw some hallucinogenic mushrooms at things. Nothing else exciting really happens in this level. There's a mini boss where you use Lumos and just stand next to some wolves and kill them. Really exciting boss design there. When you do eventually reach the Whomping Willow boss, it's pretty much that boss battle that every game copies from Super Mario 64. Once beaten, you finally get to have a look at Hogwarts Castle, and my god, at the time, it was huge. It was amazing. To finish off the day though, you work your way up to the common room, meeting Headless Nick and Hermione along the way, and then you get introduced to Fred and George's secret shop, which exchange beans for many different things, of which I buy some stink pellets and some luminous balloons, which we will get to later on. And finally, we witness our first day at Hogwarts, of which we start in the Gryffindor common room, where you will find a notice board which contains little fetch side quests, which on completion of those side quests, each one, you will get some house points and a wizard card. Our first lesson at Hogwarts though involves flying, so we make our way down the stairs. They're not really moving stairs, they're more like lift stairs because they only go up and down. When we eventually get outside, we start our flying lesson, and if you listen,
apparently is directed at you, Mr. Longbottom.
That's the same voice actor from the movie. I'm pretty sure they're the only two people from the movie which actually voice act in this game. For the flying lesson, we have to fly through some magical rings, and the only reason they're magic is because they've teleported from Superman 64. After you beat the beginner course, in quotations, she just tells you, you know what, do your exam now. Because why not? And you do it, and I did it, and I got 85, and I got A+, which gave me 80 house points. Yay! Yay! My exam concludes the lesson, and Ron says he's off to bed because he's exhausted from doing, let me just check, absolutely nothing. With the flying lesson over, you can end the day there and then, but you can also go around and explore Hogwarts to your heart's content. The Remember All will keep flashing at you to tell you to end the day, and it's really annoying, but you can still just go around, collect some stuff, and do the fetch quest all you want. When you do finally decide enough is enough, you can hit select and end the day. So now that we've completed the first day at Hogwarts, we're going to move on to the nighttime section of the game. And this is the part of the game where I would hand the controller over to my mum because it got too scary. I'm not even joking about that, and you shall soon find out why. And these sections alone are the reason why I come back to this game so often. So, what do we actually have to do tonight? We have to rescue Neville because he's got himself stuck behind a tapestry looking for his toad, Trevor.
Does anybody actually remember that happening in Chamber of Secrets? No?
No, neither do I, actually. Thankfully, Hermione's on hand to save Neville by telling us how to save Neville. Simply put, we have to go to the library to learn how to remove a plant, and then we can go to the greenhouses on the Hogwarts grounds to learn a new spell which will cut down the tapestry. And we have to do all that without getting caught. Remember those sneaking mechanics we learnt back on Diagon Alley? Well, we're going to need them a lot. The principles are still the same. If you get seen, you have enough time to get away. But if you get hit by their spell, well, then you've been caught, and you will lose 5 house points. If you're really bad at sneaking like I was as a kid, then the game does give you a bit of mercy and limits you to losing 20 points per night. For whatever reason though, the first sneaking level is possibly the hardest one in the game. Like, the difficulty range is completely reversed. As you progress, the sneaking missions on a night get even easier. But thankfully for this first prefect, I can skip right past him by using a shortcut that I know, which will take us to the stairs. You know, the bad side to using that shortcut is every time you go down it, you have a mini heart attack when you hear that. Honestly though, as a kid, that really, really scared me, and things get a lot scarier in a minute. First up, we've got to go to the library though and get that book. So when you're trying to sneak past the prefects, what you should try and do is be a bit stealthy about it, nice and quiet, not run right past them like an idiot. So you go in the library, you read the book right in front of you, and you leave. Remember those stink pellets I bought? That's their use. Now that we know how to remove those plant things, we can go to the herbology greenhouses and learn the new spell. Unfortunately though, there's quite a few prefects to go through in the lobby and also on the grounds. You know, I've never actually used one of these luminous balloons before. Let's see what they do.
There's someone around here. Hey! Locomotor Mortis!
Ah! So they make every prefect known to man find you. That's good. That's a great item. Thanks a lot. Okay, let's try setting off a balloon here and see what happens. Oh look, here they come. Here they come. Okay, they're getting closer. Let go. Okay, let's run away. Run away. Just go for the door. Run away. When I finally got bored of pissing around with the prefects, I did eventually make it to the herbology greenhouses and I did learn the new spell, Defender. It's basically just a scissors spell. When we finally get back inside, we are met with possibly the most difficult of the stealth sections in the game. Even now, it takes multiple attempts to get upstairs and into the door on the right. The biggest problem though is there's no cover as soon as you enter, and there's a prefect just around the corner. So what I do is I hide behind the hourglasses, which sometimes works, sometimes doesn't work. I think this is the perfect time to mention that the music that plays in these sneaking sections is absolutely perfect. It fits so well, and when you're spotted and you hear the ginormous thud of the orchestra, it scares you half to death, and it gives you such a big adrenaline shot.
There's someone around here. Hey!
Locomotor Mortis!
Hey, you!
Ah, Mr. Potter, breaking the news. 5 house points for Gryffindor.
Eventually, I did manage to get past them, but not without scarring myself for life when seeing the prefect orgy in front of me. I think this is why they get so angry about you leaving your dormitory at night. And then, because story has to happen, on the way back up the stairs we find Headless Nick petrified, McGonagall finds us finding Headless Nick, we get taken to Dumbledore's office, yada yada yada, Chamber of Secrets story. What isn't Chamber of Secrets story though, is we finally go back up and free Neville, Hermione's exhausted from nothing, and then when we try to warn her that there's, you know, a killer, perhaps, on the loose, she just ignores us, you know. Could all be dead in the morning, but, eh, who cares. Thankfully, we weren't all killed in the night, and we can start the second day. And first off, let's just, you know, talk to Neville, see if he's grateful for helping us. Wow. Okay. That's how it is. Fuck you too. Anyway, today we are going to Defense Against the Dark Arts with Lockhart. We obviously get chosen to go and get the Expelliarmus spell from this hole in the wall. And basically, it's just a dungeon. Your standard dungeon from any RPG ever. So yeah, you do some simple puzzles, imprison some more imps, run past some death traps, and eventually you find the spellbook. There's a boss. I didn't see that coming. Actually, that's the boss from the back of the box. Wow, looks kind of cool on there. But, EA's done some false advertising. Now, from what I can tell from the box, that spell that he's casting looks like Flipendo, but fully charged. I actually don't really know what that spell is there, because it looks a little bit different, but that's what it looks like to me. But even if that's true, or even if it's any other spell, in fact, it will just go right through him. You can't hit him with normal spells. That's where Expelliarmus comes into play. If you've ever read the book or seen the movies, Expelliarmus is the disarming spell, not a shield or a reflection spell, as it's shown in this game. And you guessed it from the footage that I'm showing in the background, it's a tennis match. It is a tennis match. You know, of all the things they could have copied from Zelda, why did they copy the most tedious fight possible? The first few hits aren't even hard, you just reflect it back and that's it. You know, it gets a bit more interesting towards the end where he actually starts reflecting it back towards you, but it's just so easy and so boring. You have to fight this boss about 6 times in the entire game. Once it's game, set, match though, you can leave the dungeon and you're thrown into yet another tennis match. Does it ever end? Now, way back when, this duel was actually really, really hard. I couldn't do it. It took me multiple tries. But if you know the strategy, it is incredibly easy. Now, as you do in this game, your first instinct is to hit somebody with Flipendo. Like, it's first instinct. Everybody does it. You do it all the time as well. When I'm just running about, I'll just Flipendo everybody, and it's funny. And they do this little animation and go, ow, 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 stop it, Harry, stop it, stop it. Now, for whatever reason, probably because they're lazy, they left this animation in when they get hit. So, if you rebound his spell with Expelliarmus and then hit him with Defindo or Flipendo or something, he'll do that little animation and then you just get an easy hit on him. It's so easy. You'll see me do it in the video. It's so easy to do. That technique makes every duel, which I think is about 3 in this game, just a joke. Anyway, you beat Malfoy, that snake thing happens that happens in the movie, and then they all start talking about how Harry's Voldemort and stuff, and then as they're leaving, something I spotted is they just left Ron standing in the hallway, just stood still like nobody would notice, because obviously they couldn't be bothered to animate him any further, they couldn't be bothered to, you know, move him around the corner a bit so then you wouldn't see him. Next, it's Quidditch practice, and yay, more rings. Woohoo. After Quidditch practice, Hermione gets bullied, and then she gets tired, and so does Ron, so they go to bed when they've done nothing again. Who honestly cares about Ron and Hermione anyway? They just do nothing in this game. Like, I don't even know why I bother mentioning them. They do nothing. The best part about finishing Quidditch practice, though, is you now have access to the broom, and through the day, you can fly around Hogwarts to your heart's content and get to new places, you know, get them wizard cards, and there's a few activities as well that you can find in the heights of Hogwarts. Now, I know what you're thinking right now. What happens if you crash while you're on the broom? Nothing at all. He just goes, ow, and like flinches a little bit. Nothing exciting. Now, there is some really, really cool things you can do with the broom. And I found this one by accident, I think a couple of years ago. But if you fly over to this specific roof side, you can actually fly through it. They didn't add any like barriers to it to stop you going through it. You can fly through it and you can essentially fly through Hogwarts, but it's got nothing in it. It's all hollow, but it's kind of funny. And also, if you fly up really high and then you go into your inventory and click end day, you'll see Harry fall to his death.
No.
With that though, we are now on night two. Tonight, Hermione wants us to go to the restricted section of the library and get the History of Hogwarts book that tells him about the Chamber of Secrets or something.
Thanks, Harry. And watch out for the prefects.
Duh, you think?
God, stupid bitch.
And so we do. We sneak past all of the prefects. Obviously, 100% successful, you know, never got caught. I just did it perfectly, honestly. Did it absolutely perfectly. When we get there, there's this really cool bit where you have to climb up the library. It's a really tall bit. It's a bit repetitive, but it looks kind of cool when you enter the room. We then have to do some platforming, some precise platforming, and trying to do precise platforming without a jump button or a climb button is, let me think of it, fucking impossible. After about 5 years of immense training at the platforming, I got the Hogwarts A History book. Now we have to escape, and when you go into the next room, you're met with some ghosts, and these ghost things are the scariest thing known to man. They still scare me every single time they scream, because sometimes they'll be off screen and they'll scream, and it just makes you really anxious, because you know you're going to get hit and fall over and lose a load of beans. What makes it worse is you're also trying to do precise platforming at the same time. And yeah, it can get pretty annoying very quickly. But at the very top of the platforming, you find the spellbook for Scourge, which gets rid of all the green goo that's everywhere. Eventually, you'll run into Malfoy and co, and you have to fight Crabbe and Goyle and Jewel. If you use the exact same strategy that I told you about earlier, it's just a joke, and I think after these two duels, you're finished with dueling for the rest of the game. Later on though, when you actually get out of the restricted area, you're put in this really awkward place back in the main library area with the few prefects, and instantaneously a prefect sees you, so you better run for that door, otherwise you're going to lose some points.
Harry!
I managed to get Hogwarts A History, but it wasn't easy. Slytherin ambush me.
Crikey!
Harry, nobody gives a shit. Can you give us the book, please? Hermione then proceeds to read the book and teach us about life. And then, when they go to bed, they must have been performing some kind of magic act, because they walk away and then they disappear right in front of your eyes. I guess you could say it was magic.